everyone. Thank you very much for having me here. My name is Stefan. I'm the computer security officer of the Organization for Nuclear Research, CERN. I am not a hacker, I'm a physicist. Some physicists believe they are hackers, at least when I see how they program. But I'm not. I've been with Insomni'hack since 2009. I was admiring what the competition was doing, and I wasn't able to do this. I was just supporting my team. It's somewhere here. Intrepids, where are you? There you are, huh? You owe me something. I would like to see some silver. So during the next hour, I would like to talk about bridging the gap between industrial control systems, the merge of industrial control systems with the Internet of Things, and IT security. So left hand side, you see our computer, our control room for running accelerators. I will come to this in a second. And on the right hand side, you have our computer center. And for me, from the perspective of security, you just manage the two the same way. You do this, the IT the same way, you do the security the same way. So I will talk in the next hour about the so-called Large Hadron Collider and give you an idea of what we have to secure, what I have to secure with my team. It's a one-time prototype, which means that you do not have a second chance. And lots of the one-time prototype is as such. You do not just lock it down once it's built, but you have to develop and maintain it and work on it permanently again and again and again, which makes my life a little more difficult because we just cannot shut down all the infrastructure, all the control systems, say, okay, hands off from this moment on, and nobody can log into, commit code, change things, and so on. So this brings me to the revolution of control systems. It is a pain in the ass, at least for me. I'm on the defense. Any old paradigm for control system do not hold anymore. I will explain to you what I mean with that one. And this, for me, means we have to handle control systems like we're handling IT systems the same way. There are some people saying you cannot patch a control system because it might threaten life or the chemical process might turn down, whatever. But if I can patch a computer center of 7,000 nodes and I can patch the 7,000 nodes within 24 hours or less, I just wonder why I can't do this to a control system. So I think there is a change of paradigm. So what is CERN? Starting with the LHC, we are the Organization of Particle Physics. We are exploring the frontiers of knowledge. Basically, what we're doing, we are running a time machine. Unfortunately, not a real one, because maybe going in the future, in the past, might be more fun. But we can go back in the past, creating conditions which happened something like 13.7 billion years ago. The physicists believe 13.7 billion years ago, there was something they call the Big Bang. Just look at all the galaxies in the universe, you can see they're all having a certain speed, and if you extrapolate them backwards, so if you take the film backwards, they all project down to a point of origin we call the Big Bang. So this is where we want to go. We'd like to understand the conditions at the Big Bang, of course not by recreating the Big Bang, since the tremendous amount of energy is not available on Earth, but at least recreating the conditions to study a couple of questions. The first question is, what's the state of matter just right after the Big Bang? So what happened at the time? There are theories for this, but nobody was there, at least I wasn't, to take a photo. So we'd like to see now how it has been done. Then there's the riddle of the universe. If you look at the universe, everything what you see shining during the night is just making up 5% of the universe. If you look at all the gravity around the universe, you come up to something like 25% of the matter. There must be more, and we have no clue what the dark matter and the dark energy in the universe is. We'd like to understand, what is this stuff? Our next question is, physicists believe that at the Big Bang there were creation of matter, may hear, but there was also the same amount of antimatter. But there is no anti-Stefan in this universe, there is no anti-Earth, there is no anti-Sun, there is no anti-galaxy in this universe. It's all gone for whatever reason, so there must be some asymmetry which made the antimatter disappear. Why? That's one of the questions. Last but not least, it's a very important question for me, is why do we have particle mass? There is no theoretical reason why particles have mass, and I would be happy if we can get rid of this mass thing, because I have too much mass. So this is a mankind's curiosity. And mankind's curiosity we are attacking worldwide. So every country you see here, not in white, is sending physicists, technicians, engineers to CERN to do together with us research to create the conditions of the Big Bang. How do we do this? It is very, very simple. If you want to understand how your mobile phone is working, you just take it out of your pocket, you can do now, and you just throw it against the wall. And when you do this, you will just fall in bits and pieces. You can look inside and understand how your mobile phone is working. We do more or less the same thing, but mobile phones are a little bit too expensive. So what we're taking is we're taking protons. Protons are us. We are made out of protons, neutrons, electrons. We take two protons. We smack them together. Like you can smack two iPhones, you get a good telephone. Just smack them together. No trust, huh? You smack two protons together. The protons, or what's inside the protons, so-called quark, interact. And in the end, it's just a question of energy. If you smack them fast enough, then you create energy densities, which are something like the same energy densities we had a billionth of a second after the Big Bang. So we do not have the overall energy of the Big Bang, but we have the same energy densities. And once we create the same energy densities, we assume that the laws of Mother Nature apply the same way as Mother Nature has applied the laws 13.7 billion years ago. And then you compare. So here we take the protons, we put the protons into bunches, so 100 billion protons in a bunch, just to increase efficiency. We put the bunches into some kind of a beam. The beam is a train of bunches are chained into a beam, and then you take the two beams and you collide the beams. So the machinery for this is very, very simple. You have the two beams, but the beams are charged of positively charged protons. You need to have a guiding apparatus to make them collide, something like rails for the train. The rails for the train are looking like this. This is our rails, so the blue thingy here, we call the Large Hadron Collider. Inside, you got the two beams and two separated tubes, and everything around is just infrastructure to keep the beams on track. And this is why it's making the life more complicated, because keeping the beams on track, the beams are very, very fast. This is why I'm saying this is controlling a Jedi lightsaber. And it's like this. The magnets which we need to guide the beams, don't think about the magnets. It's just, it's rails like the train. Our beams is the train and the rails are the magnets. You just have to make them in a circle. You have to fasten the circle and taking magnets. The magnets need to have a current of 11,000 amps. So something like 1,000 fold what you get out of the pocket here. 11,000 amps means you cannot use normal conducting cables. They will just melt away or they will be tremendously large. So we're taking superconducting cable, which means we have to cool down the accelerator. And this is where we get the blue tubes here, because all the interior here, everything here, is cooled down to -271 degrees Celsius, or 1.9 degrees Kelvin. Because in that moment, we have the cables really being superconducting. Superconducting means we can send the 10,000 amps through this without generating any heat. So this is the apparatus. And for that, we guide the beam. To get an idea of the beam, yes, I know we're in Switzerland. I'm still hoping. This is a euro for those who have never seen it. There might be some UK colleagues here. This is what you would have got if you would have voted differently last year. And this, the size of the beam is as big as Spain, 4 millimeters diameter. This is my laser saber, and it's making its turn in the machine. The problem with the laser saber is the stored energy of the beam is 80 kilograms of TNT. If the beam is getting lost in the machine, if it's hitting the beam pipe, it will cut open the beam pipe, like a laser saber, and you don't see that Darth Maul is just cut in two unless he falls down. The same thing you see here, you won't see that, it's just open. And then we go into the superconducting magnet. Superconducting magnet is cold, which means that if you now have a hot beam hitting on the superconducting magnet, it's cooled by helium, the helium will evaporate. And this will destroy our apparatus more or less over the next 100 meters. So you see, there is an interest of keeping the control system somehow under our control, not under the control of somebody else. This is why cybersecurity is getting important for us. Here's looking in reality. We are located over here in Palexpo. This is the airport, 3 kilometers. Our accelerator is 27 kilometers in circumference. Why is it big? It's the argument like with your car, take your car, 200 kilometers an hour downtown Geneva, turning right, doesn't work because the curvature is not good enough. So you have to vary an autobahn with a large curvature. The same thing as for us, we need to have an autobahn. Everything is something like 80 to 140 meters underground, just to not pose an obstacle to the people living there. And then we get the beams in. Here we are, 2,072 bunches. They're doing 11,000 turns a second. They are not stopping, even at the border here. They are not stopping, so there's no border control for those. The distance between the two bunches is 25 nanoseconds. And then we have 4 collision points, where the beams are collided. When we're in production, they collided permanently. So this is something like you fill the machine with all the beam, This takes on like 2 hours, and then you keep the beams in the machine for the next 12, 15, 20 hours, unless some of the control system is failing and declaring that there's no power anymore, cooling is lost, thunderstorms strike, and we lose power completely for the side, or whatever else is happening. But usually this is running for 20 hours. We produce collisions. This is an apparatus for taking the pictures. It's open, so this part here is usually pushed on top of that one. Here are the two beams. This is the beam pipe. Here is just one beam pipe, because with two beam pipes you can't collect the beams, so you have to put them together. To get an idea how big it is, here's a guy. So this is 40 meters in length, 20 meters in diameter, and the collision point, the actual collision point, is something like 12 meters down this apparatus. Just think of this one as a nice Canon digital camera. And we have a second one from Nikon, which is looking like this one. Here again is the beam going through. Here you see the height of a rack, which is 2 meters 40, so you get an idea again. This is 60 meters in height and something like 25 meters in length. And with those ones, we're taking the pictures. Why are those so big? If you get the collision, what's coming out of the collision is still very fast. So you need to have some space to break them down, to stop them, to really measure them. So you do not do a film. Just don't think that you get a collision, you get a film how it's happening. You just see the end product. It's like the police coming to a crime scene and then just see the dead body and the blood. But you don't see how it happened. You just have the evidence, and then you have to collect everything together and figure out what really happened. We got 3 million digital and analog control channels. We got something like 34 control systems hosted on blade servers. And in the end, there are 700,000 lines of code, but something like 1 terabyte of configuration data, which is pushed to the experiments before they start. This is how a collision is looking like. Nobody's looking at those ones, apart from on presentations, because everything analyzes is done completely automatically. But giving you now some ideas of the numbers, 25 million bunch crossings we have a second. So every time out of the bunches, something like 10 to 40 protons find a partner. So we got 10 to 40 collisions on top of this. And then you have to use computing power to figure out which collision came from which part. So it's something like taking a picture of you with an analog camera and without winding forward it of you. And then later on, you have to figure out the photos again from one film. Data rates, 1 million data channels, 10 megabytes per photo. We have a raw data rate of 1 petabyte per second. So this is what's coming out of the experiment. We cannot store that. I think there are just a very few companies worldwide who can store this, and they are all based in the US. For us, we are filtering this down with something like a filter farm of 3,000 data acquisition servers, and then you end down with 10 gigabit per second. The 10 gigabits per second are getting in our main computer center, and then they're distributed worldwide for the researcher community. And then you start doing research. This is just one of the results. What you see in red is the prediction of the theorist. This is what they take all the mathematics together. They say how the collisions should look like, what should happen. And the dots are the data. You can see in how the data drops in by date. And if you look a little more closer, you can see there is a small difference here. The red doesn't correspond to the dots. The dots really correspond to the rest. And this is then where new physics kicked in. And this new physics had a name, and the name was given by a professor who predicted this 40 years ago. And he said there must be something, a mechanism, we call after him, the Higgs mechanism. And for him it was very lucky, because he was still alive in 2013. Peter Higgs is here. And this is why he and François Englert get the Nobel Prize. So this is more or less the basic research we're doing. Is this any benefit for you? No, it is not. But, hold on. Professor Brown didn't know when he was playing with electron beams that 50 years later this is becoming a television. We had already trackpads for controlling X-ray tears before Steve Jobs even knew that he will found Apple. The World Wide Web has been developed as a protocol for exchanging design data for the LHC and others between California and CERN. So you see, those are spin-offs. Some of the X-ray are even used nowadays for medical application. The Higgs, touché, this is for the physicists to understand more how we're working. But everything else is more or less for the benefit of mankind. And we get more collision points. This is looking like the public transport of London, New York, or every other favorite city. Our beams are starting here, first gear, second gear, third gear, not very fast. Ooh, that's tedious now. Fourth gear, and then getting into the LHC, fifth gear, and then your maximum speed. You never start your Ferrari, which you got in your garage, with a sixth gear. You just destroy the gear. So you start the first gear. So we get more collision points. We have collision points for antimatter, for neutrons, and so on. And all those experiments have control systems. All those control systems need to be secured. And all the data, all the experiments spill out data which are stored in a computer center then analyzed worldwide. Worse, we got even an experiment which is not even on Earth. It's attached to the International Space Station. This is called AMS, antimatter measurement in space, more or less. And the data from there is going to a Marshall Space Center with NASA in Texas, and then it's going to our computer center again. The whole the control of this experiment is done again from the control room at CERN. So this is the scope. This is what I have to protect. Lots of control systems, lots of accelerators, lots of accelerator infrastructure. Running an accelerator, you need to have a cooling system, you need to have a powering system, you need to have different monitoring system. You know, you can challenge me. Do I know all the names of the abbreviations? I don't. I can try. I don't know that one here. Beam interlock controller, beam loss monitor, beam of flight, beam position locking, maybe. Beam position monitoring, I have no clue who Bob is. Cryo system is easy. LHC beam dumping system to get rid of the 80 kilograms of TNT once the fill is over. You have to get rid of the beam. You just cannot go in and just grab it and just put it aside. You have to dump it properly. Vacuum systems and so on. And then you got control system for the experiments. Experiments have some fancy names: ALICE, ATLAS, CMS, LHCb, and many, many more. They are the different endpoints of the accelerator. And then you got safety systems, access systems for the PS, proton synchrotron, other access systems. I don't know what that one is here. CCTV, you should know what that is. Detector safety system, LHC access system. I skip a couple of them because I don't know that this is there. Gas monitoring system, fire system, and so on. So this is all infrastructure. We have some like 100 plus control systems. And a control system might look differently. So here's the revolution of control systems. Old paradigms do not hold anymore. And that's my main problem. A control system is very simple. You measure something, for example, the temperature of this room, and you would like to trigger an actuator to control the temperature in this room. So you got a sensor here, you got an actuator here, and in between you get some controller, which in the past was something like a proprietary thingy somewhere in the corner, and you cannot just touch it, and you cannot connect to it remotely, you just have to go for touching it. Attached to this is something for us humans, a visualization system, a SCADA system, with some screens, with a mouse, with a keyboard to do the configuration. It might be the thermostat or the button which is just in the wall to dim the light in here. And then you get safety systems, which are more or less doing the same thing, apart from they're not really controlling. They're just triggering some anomalous situation, and once they've seen the anomalous situation, they pull the plug for us, meaning dump the beam, get rid of the beam, because you do not want to have the 80 kilograms of TNT circulating. You just trigger, and once you trigger the beam dump, the beam is more or less extracted from the machine. It is sent on the target. The target is a 20 meter deep, 5 meter wide carbon thingies and carbon concrete, and you send the beam on top of that, and all the energy is evaporating inside and being cooled away. In the past, it was running some obscure operating system. It was running some protocol Profibus, which was not known to anybody, but for the control system expert. You can interlink the system. You can have different sensors on the same network. You might have even a tree of networks with some data historian monitoring all the monitoring data. And then you have the nice modem, and I'm still on the generation of war games. I've seen the film in 84. So many of you youngsters have no clue what I'm talking about, but that was still fun. For you, the world is looking like this. TCP IP everywhere. So now it's called Profinet. It's called Modbus TCP. So we're using IT technologies there. We are hooking everything up to the business network. So you have your web service and your data warehouse and the office PC now more or less one hub away. And then you get a firewall to the internet, which is brilliant because if you go shopping and you buy your next BMW, you go just to the BMW dealer. You just put, since you're all Swiss, you just take out your credit card, you put it on the desk, say, would like to have that one. Give them the money, they put it in their computer, transaction done, and then you say, I would like to have it in blue, that motor, and it's going via the internet to the BMW warehouse, and then all the parameters are pushed down to the production line, and if you're lucky, by the next day, Amazon is delivering you the car. Ideally, by drone, but this is not happening. And then you got even wireless access points, and this is my next challenge for more or less this year. I'll explain to you later why I'm completely pissed off of certain developers at CERN, because they are not using fancy new IT technology, Arduinos, Raspberry Pis, and they all come with embedded VLAN interfaces. And you cannot just pick them off, and you just cannot switch them off. They're just there, which means that if they put them on my controls network, which is well protected, I have now some wireless access bridge into my controls network. And if you just come by and drive by, don't like that particular part. And look here, my pain points: Microsoft for the operating system, hooray. Wireless access points for convenience, and then the internet connection. And I need to have the internet connection because developing for the LHC, lots of development is not done at CERN. It's done somewhere in Asia or somewhere in Germany, on France, or UK, or in Americas. So the people need to have remote connection, and this is putting some pain points for me. Control system looking like this. This is a gas control system. You can still see here some old displays, but in the end, everything is ether connected. This is down in the tunnel. Here's the beam pipe. This guy is just there because there's no beam. If he wouldn't be there, if there's beam, he wouldn't feel healthy. Here's the beam going through, and lots of cables again, lots of control system all on Ethernet. Pumps, valves, small cables, the blue cables are TCP/IP Ethernet. This is a safety system, you see lots of racks, again, everything else, TCP/IP. And our control center, just one Windows screen, I'm very happy about that one. The others are all based on Linux, but honestly, once you come into that scale, you have to also fix your Linux systems, and this is also a pain point for me. So here we are. Bye bye, Bill. Welcome, Raspberry Pis and Arduinos. It's really a pain for me. Embedded devices, you cannot patch them, and you cannot patch them remotely properly. You cannot manage them remotely in bulk. We're not talking about one device, we're talking about thousands of those devices. How do you patch them? And then they are in production, which is even making more problems. You cannot just patch them like you patch your PCs on a patch Tuesday. Apart from the core and control systems, in my mind, interconnections will grow. The power system is talking to the beam lock system. The beam lock system is talking to the vacuum system. Vacuum system is talking to the cooling system, and so on. It's all interconnected. I'll show you a more technical slide on that one, how this is looking in reality. You're talking about interstitial control system, but the Internet of Things is just more or less the same thing, but you run this at home, and they will merge. I'm seeing more and more Internet of Things devices being used for controlling accelerators. And then wireless on the plant floor, I mentioned that before. And last but not least, where is the damn business model to get those devices secured? There is no incentive, there is no law, there might be some certification, there might be some NIST 800 standard in the US or CAP 02209. But in the end, every hardware I'm getting, which is for a control system, sucks. It is not secure, it has not even security in mind, it's not even robust. So if you just look at it with Nmap and it's crashing, we're not talking about security, we're talking about fundamental basic principles of designing hardware. And I see lots of youngsters here, maybe some of you are making it to Siemens, ABB, Schneider and all the others, maybe you bring those security principles into your company, so I'm getting better products. Today I'm not. And this is my challenge. So you have the same challenge, by the way. This is what I just took yesterday evening. This is my Sony television running Android. I got an Apple TV, guess what it's running? I got a Wii U, I have no clue what it's running. Surround system from Yamaha, all of them wireless capabilities, all are connected with my network. Not all of them, the Sony for example is not. I got a solar power converter on the roof, and guess what? Yes, it's internet connected because I would like to have a web page where I can read what I'm producing. I got a Sony Hi-Fi, AirPlay, must be on wireless, and then I don't, but a friend of mine is owning Nissan Leaf, and you get a nice web page which is showing the status of your car. So, very nice. So this is the same thing, and those things have been all broken by the Mirai botnet. So you see what the threat is. This might be something hip, and do more research on that one, but for me, control system IoT is the same thing. I did a survey at CERN. Here we are. This is an SCPI device controller I found on our network from Hamek. Enter your command here, go ahead. It's a frequency controller on Ethernet. Here we got a Schneider Electric thingy, and you can define your passwords here. People didn't, they're not forced to. It's a PLC, programmable logic controller. Nicely, you can see here the Ethernet port. This one is a NanoStation M2. You can see all the configuration details here. Some of them I masked. There's no security tab here. And if you look by this access point, I'm protected. Brain boxes, sounds good. There's even a security tab here. Everything is public, you can configure. And if you don't touch the password, you have the default. This is a converter from RS-232 to Ethernet again. And Teledyne LeCroy, all the details, no security. This is an oscilloscope. Last but not least, the fun one here, I like, I can't read this. No user accounts created yet. Click login and access the device with the default username, admin. And password, 1234. When I read this the first time, I changed my password. So, but now it's all good. You know what this is? It's a security camera. Internet of Things, this is, from the view of security, a complete fail. If you look in the media, I stopped getting snippets. But you see, more or less, everything has been cracked already. And you guys are doing a tremendous job in cracking. Some of you might have done this in the past. What I like most is, 2012, the US power grid is vulnerable to just everything. Yeah, that's more or less, that's true. That's hitting the spot. I will not read anything of that one, but I still like that hack. Really kudos. The wording, maybe it's saying fish off. Hard to read. But my favorite is here. Hospital equipment infected with configure. That feels good if you're just in bed and then somebody wants to come and say, oh, we have to have a reboot of your Windows computer. Just hold breath and hope for the best. For CERN, it's the same thing. We are target. Do you think it's possible for the LHC to be hacked? Really, CERN has been hacked. It's run by mad scientists. Hellbent on crazy, these are the type of people that jump from rocks with wingsuits and life mentality. Yeah. Wishful thinking. I didn't get access to databases, but hacked the website with a cross-site scripting attack. Would you like to know if you're the right person to talk about this and try to make a deal? To give you all the details. This is really ethical what happened here. We got a deal. We contacted the guy again, saying we need a little bit more hints what you found. But then the intrusion detection system spotted where he went back to the web page he cracked to make his screenshots, and with that we knew where he went in. And then last but not least, using the exploit on CERN, thank you guys, would be a win, hacking the people who created the internet. Fortunately, that exploit has not been used against CERN, and no, we did not create the internet. This has been some military agency in the US. We just made the World Wide Web on top of that. And we're not even getting a dime for this, which is a bit unfortunate, because if every click you're doing is giving us a millionth of a centime, we would build a second and a third and a fourth particle collider, maybe, and I might even have one in my basement, but here we are. But we have been hacked. Hackers see face LHC site, came close to turning off particle detectors. This is where I learned that the media is not very accurate. They have defaced a website dealing with information from the Large Hadron Collider. But they have been far away from the control system, and they have been definitely very far away from turning off particle detectors. But such life. Hackers infiltrate to mock IT security. I felt offended by that part. And then there's a very nice video, you can look for this, Black01 White. This is a Greek documentary about hacking, and they have also a small snippet on an attack against CERN in 2009, and that's a very, very nice thing. The only thing I don't like is CERN is named in parallel with the Greek military and NATO, so it doesn't fit together because we're not doing military research. So towards a joint future, I think you get now an idea what I have to protect. CERN is open environment, it's academic. People talk about bring your own device problematic, I don't. We have bring your own device since 20 years, and something like 70% on our devices on our networks are bring your own device. We're talking about office computing, 40,000 devices on the network. We're talking about 7 computer centers, each has something like between 5 and 10,000 servers, something like 100,000 hard disks, 50,000 virtual machines, and in the end we're storing something like 150 petabytes of data on hard disk plus the same amount on tape. And lots of IT services behind, 500 web servers, 10,000 websites, 1.5 million web pages. This is what we have to secure. But here we talk about control systems, 100. So the first thing which we're doing is, and I think we're doing well, is no impact, no risk. If you cannot do destruction and we cannot do any losses, then the security paradigm can be different. And I'm talking about defense here. Attacking is very simple. Theoretically, defense is at least a challenge. This is the switch you find in our control room if you want to get rid of the beam. Usually the beam is getting rid by itself because one of the control systems, the interlock systems, are kicking in and then dumping the beam. But at the end of the shift, after 28 hours, you might want to dump the beam yourself, and then you trigger and you just switch the switch here, and the beam is just gone. And the beam is really literally immediately gone. This takes something like 80 microseconds and the beam is gone. So, but for us, this is very important. Safety is important. Remember of this laser saber of the Jedi's. The safety of the beam, not the security, the safety of the beam is tremendously important. If the beam is getting lost, we have destruction of the machine. It's not doing any impact to the environment, it's just local destruction, and we are not happy about this. So resilience and robustness is the key. Important for us is, and this is why we've done impact and criticality analysis, to make sure that whatever condition is happening, we will not do destruction. We might lose the beam, which is bringing down availability, so we cannot take any collisions anymore, there's no beam in the machine, but we do not destroy. We have dozens of different safety systems which are there, and now the challenge for an attacker, and I'm not giving you the mandate to try, I'm just saying, but I'm assuming everybody of us in here has a white hat or a gray hat. Black hat is another continent. The safety systems are rigorous, so if you want to somehow manipulate the X-ray as such as doing destruction, you have to circumvent the phase space, the envelope, or something like a dozens of different safety systems. And I think there are very few people at CERN who understand how the safety systems all interlock. Even the beam is communicating, is somewhat interacting with the X-ray. Just give you an example. The water level in Lake Geneva is important for us, gravitation, and needs to be used for adjusting the beam during its orbit. When the TGV is coming from Paris to Geneva twice a day, it's coming with an electromagnetic field, it's an electric train. This field is strong enough that we can sense this with a beam. We have to correct that for. So you see, now manipulating the safety system such that we believe everything is safe and the beam is starting doing something odd, it's very hard for an attacker. And this is why we believe there we have some safety margin. Of course, if the attacker is doing something wrong, he will just do a denial of service attack, for example, and that one, he will kill one of the safety system. Safety system is dead. The last thing the safety system when it's dead is doing is saying, oh, I'm dead. And then the beam dump is kicking and saying, oh, he's dead. We just dump the beam, going to a safe state. So this will diminish availability. But this is something we can cope with. It's just, you just refill, you do another collision, and then you run for another 20 hours. Destruction will mean we have a downtime of months in the worst case. Give you an example, everything is cooled down. If somebody has forgotten his chewing gum inside, you have to warm up for weeks. You find a chewing gum or your screwdriver, 1 week. Cooling down again, 6 weeks. Just for a damn screwdriver, you take 3 months downtime just to find it. So this gives you an idea what can happen. Here's my interconnections. Every color is a control system. Every black thingy is a device, part of the control system. I like the green one because for the green one you can see it has something like a very, very homogeneous structure. It has a tree structure. The device is talking to a collector, different collectors are talking to a master, and the master is talking to the outside world. Nice. This is a cell. I can well protect the cell because I can put something in an envelope like firewalls, network protection, whatever, VLANs around those ones. The blue one is already looking clumsy. Look, all that, or the black, the violet, or the what is this, magenta? No. This pinky thingy here is looking even worse, and you see they are interconnected. So all my systems are somewhat interconnected. Now tell me, how do you want to defend that? Putting in firewalls? Yes, I can put in firewalls. How would the rule set look for the firewall permit anyway? So in the end, I'm compliant. I'm compliant with SIP 00002 or with NIST 853. I'm compliant. Do you have a firewall? Yes, I have a firewall. Permit any doesn't matter, but in the end I'm compliant. But this is not my goal. I would like to have rules in, and we're working on this to get rules. And I can tell you there are even some control systems where the vendors do not really understand which protocols they're talking. So what are you listening on? Yeah, we need to have telnet. Oh God. Good, you get your telnet, we make an opening for telnet. And then yes, we need to have some higher ports open, but we don't actually want. We're hopping. So you would get a knocking port, like a TFTP knock, and then you open a higher port. So in the end, your firewall is looking like you close down the lower ports and then you open all range on top because this damn protocol is set up in a way that it's not saying we are talking only on port 80 or 443. No, we're talking about 20,000 to 35,000. So that's my challenge. But at least I'm lucky. This is why I gave it two green tick marks here, I know my assets. Every device on my network, hopefully, is registered, and I have a name behind, I have a contact point behind. Every virtual machine has a name behind I can contact. Every database is registered, I get a name behind. Accounts, websites, there's always a name behind. Why is this important for me? Because then I can talk to people and ask them, which ports do you really need to have open? Even if the answer is, what? But this is my world. We have ownership in automatic life cycles in some parts. So if you leave the organization but you own a web page, we delete just the web page if it's your personal one. I would like to see the same with the account. We close down the account. In the future, hopefully someday, I might even have devices which belong to you being purged from our database once you leave. But now if you own the web server of CERN and you leave and I delete the web server of CERN, it might not be good for operations. So we have to see. And we started doing an analysis of hidden identity dependencies. If somebody wants to do a PhD, my email address is down here. That is worth at least a couple of PhDs. So I have a few students having had their teeth on that one, and we came always back with the conclusion we cannot put a firewall envelope around because people just don't understand the protocols they're talking in depth. So it's a pain factor. But we're coming closer. I gave myself 2 out of 3 points. Fair. Also, technology is used, and yes, there's the Windows XP used at CERN. You think, why can you, from a security point of view, why can you? Because it is a 100,000 Swiss francs worth oscilloscope, and you cannot patch it, and you cannot upgrade this to Windows 10. It's just the box running Windows, and people not using this as a computer, but as an oscilloscope. So what do? We have to now fence it around, just protect it somewhere else. So I'm happy because we got an IT department, which is like, listen, Frodo, to rule them all. And this is one of our main paradigms. We have one IT department which is doing the networking. They're providing the databases. They're providing the virtual machines and the operating system. We have one single sign-on managed by IT professionals, storage and web servers. This is not because I dislike the control system experts, but it's already in the name. Those are control system experts. They are experts on control systems, but not necessarily in setting up a web server, and I can tell you, no, they are not, or a database, or designing their own network. So we did a deal, and we're moving closer to merge those two realms. The network is handled by the networking team, like in the computer center we do for the control system. Same operating system, same databases. We're using Puppet in the computer center. Our control system experts, for whatever reason, use Ansible. So there's still some work to be done. In the end, I would like to see it just being one used for both sides. But we're using more or less the same technologies, same support team, same people. Why is this good for security? We cannot debate whether a homogeneous system is better in security than a heterogeneous system. For me, if I have one team of experts trained professionally also on security aspects, running the show and securing the show is much better than me going around talking to the servers and databases in experiment A, in the beams department, in IT for the finance department. Having pockets of database around the site for me is a nightmare. So we just try to move everything together, everything centralized. And think of that, we're in an academic environment, they are physicists. If you don't give them whatever they want to, they just develop this themselves. So you don't give them their blue Joomla installation, they just set up a web server somewhere in the corner, connect to our network, and then it's running. The only good thing for me is this web server will never make it to the internet because I control the firewall and they have to make a formal request. And when they make a formal request, I ask the question, why is an Ubuntu laptop for a web server which is production? Have you thinking of patching? Does your manager know how to patch it once you're gone? Then looking at the web page, they're physicists, students, brilliant things. This is web technologies, modern web technologies with everything, but then using HTTP for login, process scripting, SQL injection, and then it's usually pity, in particular during summer when the summer students are coming, they're all developing web nowadays. So if you've got summer students coming in, it's either web, it's either Java, or they're doing some iOS application. So the web ones come then to me, would like to have the opening. And then it's a little bit of a sad story because some of them come after, at the end of the project saying, look here, I've got the web server here, laptop, Ubuntu in the corner, can I have an internet opening? And then I have to say, come on, your setup is completely screwed, so you can get a thank you and you're not getting any opening. And then there are tears, yeah. And I'm getting angry calls from the supervisors. And my only thing is saying, just contact us beforehand and we can help you. So this is more or less where I am pushing for having same people, same support, professionals doing the job. And we have adapted priorities. Of course, we do not patch the X-Rater when Bill Gates is saying it's patch Tuesday again. So there are timelines where you can do the patching, and yes, you cannot patch an X-Rater control system every month. You have to wait for scheduled downtimes and then you do this. Same thing for the computer center. But the computer center there, as I said before, fixing 7,000 nodes within 48 or 24 hours, we did this in the past. We had brilliant professionals there. You just tell them this is now a Linux remote root escalation vulnerability visible to the internet. There you go, fix it. And then they just drain the queues, they stop everything, and then they reinstall the servers even if they need, or they patch the servers. We had even reinstallation things where we didn't know whether we've been compromised or not, so we reinstalled 5,000 servers over a time of 24 hours. But it's all puppetized, it's just on the click of the mouse. Software development, same thing again. Don't believe that developing software for control system is nowadays different. Maybe they're using some different languages, and I've seen some physicists pushing some C code into a PLC, which doesn't work, but they managed for some reason. But in the end, it's the same thing for other programming. What you see here on the left-hand side, I should use this one here. This is programming ladder diagrams. I think this is for LabVIEW. Somebody knows LabVIEW? Is this LabVIEW? Yes, LabVIEW, Vico, somewhere? Yes, LabVIEW. So, but we're trying to use the same software development lifecycle, using the same tools, even for control system, Git, GitLab, Jenkins, Koji, Maven, having static code analyzers in the loop so we can at least see how many hiccups, how many blunders have been implemented by the physicists. Still, this is on a voluntary basis. I know there are lots and lots of developers. I have no clue about you, but if you're developing, are you using GCC minus W all, or are you just ignoring this because when GCC is not complaining at all, it's good, and you don't look at all the warnings? Please look at the warnings. That's what I'm telling the people. Run static code analysis. We'll be providing them from the security team. Anything you want to, for PHP, for Perl, for Python, for Java, for C, C++, it's all there. You just need to get this Docker image into your build process, and you run the tools. And yes, of course, you had lots and lots of warnings afterwards. But from a security perspective, if you have them all, got rid of all the warnings, you got a clean and sober code, at least to the knowledge of my static code analysis. And there's a huge effort needed to integrate commercial products. If you get a PLC from Siemens, they have their own development suite, and now you have to see how you integrate this. So what we're doing is, and I give us one point here, so it's one point. Can still improve. Training people, we're doing, it's sometimes fun. This is the training for LabVIEW here again. And we're doing similar training for IT professionals and for control system experts. They're learning how to program securely in Java and C++, PHP, Python, whatever else. I still wonder why are the students are coming from university having a concept of operating systems, of networking, of databases, of web servers, but no clue about how to secure them. So to me, what I learned is, for your bachelor, you learn how you run this, and for the master, you might follow the security courses. I think this is completely wrong. The security must be part of the training from the very beginning, but it is not. So what we are doing is we're doing serious gaming, for example. This is with Kaspersky. They have an industrial simulation. It's a card game with a tablet, and you're running a water purification plant here with 1, 2, 3, 4 entities, and then two lines. And it's a two-hour game where you have to protect this plant, and you get some gaming cards, and you get your iPad, and then there's somebody attacking your plant, virtually, of course, and then you have to respond. And the end game is just your competition with other teams. We run this with 80 people. It's like the capture the flag for novices, and you have to protect this. It's not called capture the flag now, I think it's defend the flag. But the people then have to protect their systems, and if they don't do it properly, they lose revenue. So after 2 hours, you see which team did the maximum protection, and it was very interesting for those people to learn how to really protect a control system. So this way you start getting them concepts in like antivirus, firewall, intrusion detection system, data historian, and why certain hardware should not be used. We're going even a step further. We're training people becoming white hats. I got some white hats on CERN site. Very happy about those guys. And they're giving our people who are interested courses in penetration testing and vulnerability assessments. No, this is not worth for a capture the flag here. Definitely not. We're not going in depth. But if those people understand how to figure out there's a cross-site scripting vulnerability, and then SQL injection or command line injection, they start thinking of why is it good to sanitize the input? Why is it good to filter the input? This is basics. And those people, we trained 120 people so far, they're then going back and testing the systems themselves. So it's a kind of mental training for them to build, give us better and more secure products. Getting them here for capture the flag, I think is much too premature, but maybe some of them will do in the future. What I'm saying here, responsible disclosure fails, is yes, we found also lots of devices, embedded devices which were vulnerable, and you inform the vendor, and you get a staggering silence, and you inform the vendor again, you still get a staggering silence, and in the end, you just let it drop, and you just put some protections behind. So, and here's my rant. Why do students come without security knowledge? Some of them don't, but the majority I see are coming only with some basics. Still, three dots for us. Computer emergency response. We have one security emergency response team ruling this all. The graph here showing you my intrusion detection system. There's no secret. We have lots of monitoring points. We're taking for IDS intrusion detection system is based on Bro, Lindblad Snort. We're taking system logs coming from our computing clusters, the 7,000 nodes, every syslog messages. We're even going down and logging your commands. We're using forgot what the tool is. Now it's embedded in the kernel, Active Directory, single sign-on, web logs. Everything is going into a machine where we compare this with the intelligence coming from external providers. So intelligence data, malicious domain, malicious IPs, whatever else you got. Online, we analyze the data. If you get a new intelligence, a new IOC in, we even compare this with the past. And then we send automatic emails to the owners of the devices. You know, remember, I know who's owning the web page, I know who's owning the device, so you get a device email saying, okay, your web page is vulnerable to cross-site scripting, fix it, because it's your web page, you have to fix it, I'm not fixing the web page for you. So in the end, we're doing the same vulnerability management for controlled devices, but with different timelines. The more exposure to the internet, the more urgent it's getting. So Linux clusters, which are web servers visible to the internet, or even worse, interactive Linux clusters where people can SSH into from the internet, needs to be patched first. The control system Linux systems have a little more time later. How much data do we take? It's something like 3 terabytes of security data per day, which we're ingressing. We're analyzing them live, and we're doing this auto notification for stakeholders. Only the high-level incidents, where I really think this is now really where the shit is hitting the fan, is then when the security team is getting involved, and then we're taking over the service and doing remediation. And this is why we have one emergency response team. So I think we're doing quite well there, at least. We haven't been in the headlines in the past couple of years, which doesn't mean there's nothing happening at CERN. There is, but as long as it's not going against our reputation, it's good. So it's contained and controlled, and since I'm working in security, and I may be too frank for this business, do I know whether our computer center is compromised at this very moment? If I would be now a high-level manager, I would say no, definitely not, but I'm a security guy, I just can't tell you. The only thing I can tell you is, if it's compromised at this very moment, there is no very noisy malicious activity going on. If I would tell you that, yes, we are completely secure, you would figure out that I'm working for a vendor selling you an appliance or whatever else, but there is no 100% security. Here's our control center. You see lots of screens here, and you see more screens, so there are 4 islands, 1 island, 2, 3, 4 islands. This is the LHC island, this is one of the pre-accelerators, this is the injector complex, so the smaller ones, gear 1, 2, 3, remember, and this is infrastructure. Permanent installation of the control system is impossible. We need to have remote access, so we have to find an acceptance balance between remote access and not. And now you say password authentication is sufficient. No, it is not. Go for multi-factor. Yes, we like to go for multi-factor, and we tried, but rolling out multi-factor authentication for Linux and for Windows is a pain. If you have a solution, my email address is again down here. First, I can't handle just one factor. If you say you just use crypto cards or SSID or whatever else, doesn't work. I have some people who have a mobile phone, so we can use Google Authenticator. Others are using a YubiKey because they got a USB port. I get mine somewhere here. Here it is. That's fine, but my mobile phone doesn't have a USB port, doesn't work. Smart cards, but smart chip readers embedded in your computer is not existing anymore. Finding a driver for Linux is even more harder. So you see, there is no silver bullet. You need to have many different tokens. And then integration into SSH PAM should be easy. There are the PAM modules for, but no, if you have Kerberos authentication, password authentication, SSH key authentication, plus multi-factor, PAM is not making your life very easy, and it does not fly as easy. I think with CentOS 7 now it might get easier. But in the past, we were struggling, and I'm not struggling because I have no clue what I'm talking about, but I get experts who know what I'm talking about, and they have tried getting the PAM stack somehow implemented such you can do the two things in parallel. And it's not, at the moment, fulfilling all our use cases. Finding a solution for Windows, the only answer is go to Azure. Yes, very good. All my control system moving to California, and then we do it there. No, it's not an option. And finding a plugin for Windows, if you have one which you're happy with and you can deploy on more than one PC without any big fiddling around, again, my email address is here. I'm really interested. So, fail. Yeah. And then we get the one-time prototype of the LHC. Double fail. Why? Because we cannot have independent test stands. This is the idea of a one-time prototype. If I have test stands, I have a second prototype where I can do the testing. But lots of development rollout, you need to have the live machine. You need to have the live machine because your beam is interacting with your control system. And if you don't have beam, you cannot test your control system. But you cannot have a second machine where you get the same beam as a test machine because, again, it's a one-time prototype. So we have some like 600 virtual machines used by the developers, and all of those ones have, from one time or the other, direct access to the control system directly from the virtual machine. This is my biggest working place I have at this very moment. Multi-factor authentication to the rescue, but recall the slide before, does not fly yet. And then final development can only be done on the real hardware because this is where your control system is directly interacting with the beam. And the beam is interacting with everything. The beam is a charged thingy, and it's interacting with the beam tube, with your cooling system, with the power system, and so on. Last slide. I'm looking for incentives. We scanned in the past, 2007 or whatever, we scanned our control system using Nessus. It's not really professional, but this is the maximum I can do in terms of hacking. So I was running Nessus, and I think I've done it well. I was able to crash 70% of the devices, I can say. 15 other percent of the devices, you crash the web server because you're just giving it 8,000 characters in the URL, or you crash the FTP server because you're giving it 8,000 characters for the username and so on. I know it's basic, it's for you. I would score on that one maybe the last or last but one. But there we are, those devices have no security design. We've got a oscilloscope with a blue screen here. We got one of the Intrepid guys hacking into this dosimeter reader here. You put your dosimeter in here. Here's the Ethernet cable. It took you how long? 70 seconds, denial of service, crashing or provoking a core dump, and then using a TFTP or Telnet, don't recall anymore. No, TFTP to extract the core dump. And what do you find in the core dump? Telnet password. Here we are, 70 seconds. You can talk to the vendor. You can figure out what the vendor is. The vendor are very nice guys. They are bright. They are doing very nice products. It's a brilliant dosimeter reader. But the security is not the mindset. And then we got here a chassis. This is a VMA crate. Usually you get the power in here. Here you see Ethernet ports. Something like 60 seconds denial of service against that one. All the buttons on this box are dead. So you still have your 12 volts, which is good. But toggling or controlling is dead. No problem, Stefan, go there, pull the 220 volts plug and put it back again and reset and everything is fine. Good. How many students do you need to reset 1,000 of those ones? So, device insecurity is a major problem. If you're working for a company producing control system, listen to me, please. If you're doing consulting, consult harder, push them. Why can't we make the manufacturers liable? There's just two products worldwide where the liability is with me and I'm bearing the cost. Which one is the software, of course? What is the second? Cocaine. So, why can't we have any incentive to get products which are secure? I would like to give it to Microsoft now and just tell them, give me something more secure, because I'm bearing the cost. I'm running a security team. We are chasing vulnerabilities. We're doing penetration testing. We're training white hats to get all their products more secured. Why do I need to have the cost? Why can't I get an access point or an RS-232 converter or whatever else in a secure fashion? Here's my suggestion. Maybe this is bouncing off or not, is enforce back bounty programs. Everybody who's producing software or hardware must pay the fine of the first vulnerability money according to a catalog which is defined, maybe even worldwide. Cross-site scripting vulnerability, you're getting 1,000. SQL injection 10,000, command line execution vulnerability 100,000. I don't care about the numbers. But the company is obliged to pay to the first, and then it's doing responsible disclosure. You might even scale this on users of devices. So my small program I just developed last night with a cross-site scripting vulnerability, which I put in so you get the money, is not giving you a lot because just use one user, me. But if you find something in Chrome or on Windows, it's scaling with the dissemination of the device. And we just do this for proprietary software. For open source, and this is where the national governments must come in, the government is paying. Because who's paying for open software? This is open source. Open source is open source, so there's no real owner behind. There's somebody who started this, and then it's spinning off. So you can't oblige you or you to pay if you find something. So a hard plead, the government will pay. But think of that twice. Vendors with proprietary software might now decide, I am engaging on security and I spend the money in-house instead of giving it to you because you found something. Or I don't care and I pay you the money. Or I make my software open source and the government is paying the money. And for everybody of us, the advantage is, instead of going on to the black market and selling your exploits for a tremendous amount of money but being completely unethical, you might make a little bit of money legally, and you can get a profession out of that one. So most of you are professions anyhow, but think of the students at universities who would like to get some money. So maybe this is driving off, and there are lots and lots of questions which are definitely not addressed here, but you see it, just have four lines on my last slide. Here we are in summary. I hope I was able to convince you that we're living in a life of symbiosis with industrial control systems. If you're not convinced yet, just think of a power outage in your city for a month. No cooling anymore, your food will warm up. You cannot go shopping because same for the supermarket. You cannot go to paying because everybody is paying with credit cards. You can't take your car anymore because the fueling pumps and the fueling station are on power. If you are if you are ill and you need medicine which needs to be cold, good luck for you. If you're in the hospital, hospital diesel might last for how long? We're living in symbiosis control systems and we need to secure this infrastructure and we don't. Nobody's interested in that one. Interconnections will open up. Internet of Things is just the best example, and the LHC is another example where we have to open up connections between control systems and even to the developers which are sitting worldwide. For us, resilience through safety systems is the core, and I'm working more and more with people so that we even can get the servers, the Windows servers, the Linux servers which we're using in a redundant fashion that we can patch more quickly so we have redundancy, more resilience there. And last but not least, we try to apply the same methods for security in the data center as for industrial control systems. There for me is no difference anymore. There are lots of people saying you cannot do it the same way. I believe we will have to do it in the same way or we will die. Think of the Internet of Things. This will not continue like this one. In the future, we need to have a 5G solution or we will be completely at loss to the attackers who are taking over, like the mirror botnet or something similar. And then, incentives for getting more secure products. I'm looking and longing forward. Maybe on my helm, on the security officer, I might not survive and I just see it, but I'm still hoping. So if you come to CERN, you can see CERN here. This is the Atlas experiment again, which I've shown before. This is in the film Angels and Demons. No, we do not have a control room at mid-level because this is not very good for the people working there. If you like Muppets, you can see our experiment in Muppet film. Come to us, 2019, we got open days. You can even go down into the tunnels and look at the experiments yourself, like the people here did in 2013. And if you know how to use Google Street View, you can pull a small figure onto our computer center and do a virtual tour through the computer center to see what it's looking like. And yes, you do, I see IP addresses and device names. But again, this is my environment. You wouldn't do it like this, but security for obscurity doesn't work. You really need to be more proactive. Thank you very much. I'm really Swiss, huh? It's just on time. Actually, I'm not Swiss at all. We have questions. Completely opaque or Nicola.
So when you say there's no difference between traditional IT and ICS, and you do the same, does it mean you put antivirus software on the control systems?
We have some control systems where we deploy antivirus software, yes. There's always the fight of convincing the people that no, the antivirus software is not taking too much CPU power, and we have some control systems where the antivirus software was triggering on the controls processors. You have to work around. But we managed to even put antivirus software into an oscilloscope and managing the oscilloscope windows with WSUS. So yes, it's working, but no, it's not working in each of the cases. So, but yes, I'm pushing forward for this one. We can now debate whether antivirus software is a good security mechanism or not, but still I believe even getting 30% security and detecting the usual shit is already a good thing. So, more questions?
How many people are you in the world IT teams?
Oh, how many people are on the IT team?
Yeah, the world team.
So we have to distinguish. How many people at CERN are doing IT?
Yeah.
We're talking about a couple of thousands. But this means programming and so on. So we have an IT department, which is running all the computer center, the network team, the database team, the Windows teams. This is something like 300 people running computing services. For development, for example, for the X-Rater, based on Java or for the industrial control system, I think the department strength is something like another 600 people which are doing development there. But this is then really purely development, not only programming, but also developing the hardware, doing the PCBs, integration tests, and so on. Security team, we are something like six people plus two, three, four students.
Okay.
Why are you laughing?
No,
I don't want to have a big security team, because having a security conference as such, I'm very sorry to say that, but it's an anathema. This is wrong. We don't have maintainability conferences, functionality conferences, usability conferences. This is not existing. We need to be integrated into the overall. And at CERN, my security team is not doing database security. I have a database team who is doing database security, and we are just talking to them. We have a web service team which is doing secure web services, Drupal, SharePoint, whatever else, and we're talking to them. The network team is doing a network secure network design, and we talk to them. So the security is distributed or delegated to everybody at CERN. I am security officer. I am not the person responsible for computer security at CERN, because, bring your own device, I don't control the endpoints. Most of the services I do not control. I have not the power to impose things on people. So how can I be responsible for something I do not control? I don't have a license for running a motorcycle. I'm not taking responsibility if I'm running or driving a motorcycle. This doesn't work. So we delegated this, and I'm just taking responsibility over if there's the need to. More questions?
Yeah,
last
one. Are you sleeping well during the night?
I sleep very, very well. I enjoy this job. It's nice and fun, and yes, I get a tremendous good team which is taking care. So I'm replaceable. So there are others on my team which can stand here, giving you a similar presentation, their style, and they can secure CERN. So it's teamwork, it's team effort, like what you're doing in the CTF. You don't win alone, you win by a team of 5-8 people. More questions? Very good, everybody's longing for the coffee. Thank you very much.